A very good evening to you. I'm Lisa Lord, and in our news, government looking for a new deal with the Barbados Light and Power Company, which could see new energy producers entering the market. The opposition wants government to spell out its plan for the creative economy. An elderly Christchurch woman receives keys to her new home. And in sports, Barbados women cricketers can now earn a spot in the 2022 Commonwealth Games.
Broadcasting from our studios in the Pines, St. Michael, this is CBC Newsnight, starting now.
And in our top story, police and fire officials are on the scene of a fire at Bees Recycling Plant in Vaucluse, St. Thomas. Fire officials tell CBC News the report of the blaze came in around 26 minutes to 5 this evening. The billowing black smoke could clearly be seen from miles away, including from the roof here at CBC. Now, as a consequence, residents living downwind of the fire in West Terrace, Arthur Seat, Holders Hill and surrounding areas mostly affected by smoke are asked to take precautions. Four water tenders and several officers under the command of the chief fire officer reportedly responded to the blaze. Bees Recycling was last affected by fire back in 2013 when its Vaucluse plant sustained more than $500,000 in damage. Light and Power's monopoly in the local electricity generation sector could be coming to an end. Minister of Energy and Water Resources Wilfred Abrams says other independent power producers have expressed an interest in entering the market. He made the revelation as he led off debate on the second reading of the Electric Light and Power Amendment Bill in the lower house. Our Shariko Griffith has those details.
Barbados's production of renewable energy is expected to quadruple over the next decade, and overseas energy producers are hoping to capitalize on this. In fact, Energy Minister Wilfred Abrams says he's been informed there's over $200 million in potential investment currently sitting in at least one commercial bank.
Other independent power producers have contacted us, and they're looking to get in on the business in Barbados. They want to come and help generate electricity in Barbados. They want to set up solar projects. They want to develop the wind industry. They want to look at offshore wave tech and ocean energy.
With electricity consumption expected to rise with the addition of electric buses and more electric vehicles, the minister says new players in the market would be a good thing.
Competition is good. We know what the current cost of electricity is, but we don't know what the current cost of electricity could be if competition was in. If somebody else comes in with better equipment, better technology, better everything, then the cost of electricity is going to go down. And if the cost of electricity starts to come down, then it's going to have to be passed on to the consumer.
However, Minister Abrams says potential new investments in the energy sector are being hampered by government's inability to reach a new license agreement with the Barbados Light and Power after months of negotiations.
They're not prepared to make that investment as well if they're not certain of the pricing structure, the modality for pricing, and also the license for the utility. So people don't just look in and say, what can we do to get ahead? They look at how the existing players in the market are being treated. Our failure to conclude a license with Light and Power has actually been hurting the development of the renewable energy space in Barbados.
The BLMP's existing license expires in 10 years. Shariko Griffith, CBC News.
Well, the official Barbados delegation is about to head to Trinidad and Tobago on Thursday to attend the 14th edition of the Caribbean Festival of Arts, or Cari Festa. And the island is expected to be very well represented by visual artists, writers, craftspeople, and in areas like film. And here to tell us much more about that upcoming festival is Film Commissioner with the National Cultural Foundation, Annette Nias. Good evening.
Good evening, Lisa.
How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Thanks for joining us. Now, can you tell us broadly about the island's participation in this festival?
Well, as you rightly said, it's going to be very well represented. Mm-hmm. The delegation will be 65 persons strong. There'll be a ministerial delegation led by Minister John King and a performance or, you know, artistic delegation led by members of the National Cultural Foundation. This will include, well, it's under the theme from rum to Rihanna. Mm-hmm. And this will include a theater presentation, We're Good for the Goose, a country night presentation, which will be on Saturday night, called Last Skeins, and this will be led by our dance officer, a visual arts presentation, which will encompass about 4 or 5 Barbadian visual artists, and that will be a part of a Caribbean exhibition.
Now let's deal specifically with films. What type of films will be
so in film? After a call in May, we received about 8 films, and 4 have been selected by the Trinidad authorities. These include Liquid Gold, The Story of Rum by Romel Hall, so that's in keeping with the theme, mm-hmm. from Rum to Rihanna. Jill Walker, An Artistic Life, made by Penelope Hynum, well-known filmmaker. And Klish Gittins had 2 films selected, The Fisheries and Island Strong. These are 4 documentary films of very high quality, which I'm sure will represent Barbados well.
Now you said that they chose the films.
Yes.
Is that normal?
Yes.
It is?
Because they've twinned with the Trinidad and Tobago Film Festival, so they're running it as a professional film festival.
Are you pleased with the level of films, though?
Of course, mm-hmm. yes.
And I mean, not specifically the ones chosen for Cary Festa, but that are being produced here.
I think we can do better. I think an injection of money is needed, mm-hmm. to assist people with their projects. It's not exactly the cheapest genre of arts to pursue, and so investment is necessary.
Outside of the money aspect, though, in terms of the actual talent that we have on the island?
I believe in Barbadians.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I think it's, I think the talent just needs to be honed. It needs to be recognized, honed, and there needs to be investment.
65 member delegation, that's fairly huge. So.
Yes. I think the theater presentation and country night presentation will take up a large part of that. They're like right now as we speak rehearsing, one of the final rehearsals. It's very exciting work, very, very hardworking artists, dancers, actors, musicians. And it includes a band, a tuk band, and talented creatives.
Thank you very much. And we wish Barbados the best of luck.
Thank you. I'm sure we'll make the island proud.
Indeed, as always. And that is Anat Nias, the film commissioner with the National Cultural Foundation, telling us more about Cary Festa 14. Well, the opposition People's Party for Democracy and Development wants government to reveal its plan for the creative economy. The party spokesperson on the sector, Alan Springer, made the appeal during a media conference yesterday.
The rest of the world has caught on and shown us that a functioning creative economy is key to developing a national economy and the new economies of the 21st century. We call on government, therefore, to urgently present the nation with a growth plan that addresses the economic opportunity that comes from developing a genuine creative economy.
Mr. Springer also believes that more non-musical events should be added to next year's cropover calendar.
I went through the cropover calendar for this year, and there were actually 77 events listed in total from May to August. Of that 77, 68 events, I noted, had some kind of carnival or music theme. Some kind of one another, carnival or music. That left just 9 events that were strictly non-carnival.
Former Police Commissioner Darwin Dotton is to spearhead the security arrangements for the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, or UNCTAD, which will be held here in Barbados next year. And he will start work soon on dealing with human trafficking. Attorney General Dale Marshall says these are some of the duties assigned to the former commissioner, who was brought back as an advisor to government on crime. Now, the move caused a public outcry, with some accusing the Mia Amor Motley-led administration of undermining the current commissioner, Tyrone Griffith. Speaking at the annual general meeting of the Barbados Association of Journalists and Media Workers, or BARJAM, Mr. Marshall said Mr. Dotton is one of several highly skilled retirees pressed back into duty.
Barbados does not have a surplus of resources, okay? Plain and simple. We talk a good talk. Everybody likes to sound pretty. But when it comes to actually having the skills that are needed to discharge the particular duty, it will almost always fall on the same few people. Now, I can see no reason why we should not look at individuals who have transitioned out of the system for whatever reason to bring them back in to help us.
A greater investment is to be made to increase the delivery of technical and vocational training in secondary schools. Minister of Education, Technological and Vocational Training Santia Bradshaw says the ministry is moving to introduce levels 1 and 2 certification in a number of secondary institutions. The ministry is therefore planning to deploy the necessary resources, which will include equipment and technological upgrades.
The entire population is really, tired of a focus only on academic or waiting on persons to leave educational institutions to then have to be able to pursue skills. And we believe that we must lay the foundation from an earlier level so that we can maybe even start the 1 and 2 in school and then move on, build on that, and then you have other institutions at the tertiary level that can provide the other stages. But we have to look at revamping it in such a way with the input of TVET, certainly, to be able to allow us to be able to expand technical and vocational training across the curriculum.
And Minister Bradshaw says the ministry is also considering introducing scholarships for people who excel in technological and vocational fields. She was speaking during a media briefing to present the 17-member delegation, which will leave for Russia next week. And this is to compete in the 45th Biennial World Skills Competition. Executive Director of the TVET Council, Henderson Eastman, explains that the delegation includes 6 competitors from the 2018 World Skills Barbados Competition who earned gold in their respective fields.
The 6 are Tariq Ward, car painting, Shea White, cooking, Fabo Sampson, fashion technology, Kristen Patrick, graphic design technology, Zaria Archer, hairdressing, and Danny Mears, restaurant service. They earned this opportunity to represent their country in Kazan 2019 by achieving 75% or more in the final World Skills Barbados competition and 80% or more in the competitors' developmental program with focus on the soft skills. So we are setting high standards in both the technical areas and both in the behavioral aspects.
Barbadians are being encouraged to, wherever possible, support each other and help build out communities across the island. This appeal from Member of Parliament for Christchurch West Central, Adrian Ford, who made the comment as he handed over the keys and ownership documents to new homeowner Miss Pauline Wilcher. Miss Wilcher, a senior citizen, lost her home at Sargent's Village in Christchurch during the passage of Hurricane Tomas over a decade ago. Mr. Ford, who is also the Minister of Community Empowerment, has stressed that building a community-minded Barbados is at the core of his government's agenda.
I want to thank the guys from Corner Rock Construction who decided to use all the hands of the community. The mason came from within the community, the carpenters came from within the community, the guys who did the landscape came from within the community. You had youngsters who lime on the block, come over to help move the bush. This is the sort of community spirit that is needed in Barbados. And it represents the type of Barbados that we intend to lead as a government, a Barbados that recognize that those who contributed by blood, sweat, and tears, that they must have a safe, peaceful place to call home.
And an elated Ms. Wilcher thanked government and residents of the community for the assistance.
Thank my constituency representative. And I thank Maria Batchel and many other hands that helped me, you know, to get as far as I is. And I thank all those who were on it. My,
Mr. King.
Mr. King, he was overseer of everything.
Yeah.
And I thank all those again, and I thank the government of Barbados, the Right Honorable Mayor Motley. I thank her for this, my prayer for the whole government.
The Barbados National Terminal Company Limited says that work is progressing smoothly on its pipeline maintenance program, Operations Supervisor Terrence Strawn says the recently completed work just outside of the Foundation School at Churchill in Christchurch brings to 4 of 14 the number of sites repaired to date. The next critical phase will be done at the intersection with Church Road, and that is expected to start in a few days' time. Mr. Strawn was speaking to CBC News following a town hall meeting for residents of Churchill and surrounding areas who are likely to be impacted by the work. He says except for a few minor hiccups, everything has gone smoothly.
There were one or two challenges initially given that we did not foresee. One being the weather. That certainly had an impact on the work itself. And then we had to bring personnel from Trinidad to do the quality assessment on the work itself. And that was a challenge given that persons were coming in during the crop over season and they could not get a flight from Trinidad. And of course, we took a decision not to do any work during the crop over weekend because of the high risk involved and personnel coming on site influenced by the crop over activities.
Regional news now, and a confrontation between a bus operator and municipal police in Spanish Town St. Andrew caught on camera. Now, there are calls for the cops to be armed. We get more in this report from TVJ.
This altercation between two municipal police officers, bus driver and his conductor, ended with one of the officers suffering a broken jaw. The incident happened in July on King Street in Spanish Town St. Catherine. But that was just one of several such incidents. William Manava, the enforcement officer of the St. Catherine Municipal Corporation, says he too was attacked and injured on the job.
Me was hit by a stone at Burke Road. Our vehicle windshield was hit out by unruly taxi drivers and vendors along Burke Road the same day.
Mr. Malava believes the municipal officers are constables, yet they are not armed with guns or pepper spray. Mr. Malava is lobbying for a change. He wants at least some of his fellow municipal officers to be armed.
What I would do is to make sure that special person would be out with the team are in a position where he or she can respond very quickly.
He says order is needed in Spanish Town, especially among the vendors and taxi operators who constantly block the roads. Bus drivers are not excluded.
In Trinidad, Prime Minister Dr. Keith Rowley has rescinded the decision to appoint Senator Garvin Simonet as Public Administration Minister, opting instead to take over that portfolio himself. This after pictures started circulating of a 2014 mugshot of Simonet in the U.S. More in this report.
If all had gone according to plan, Garvin Simonet would have been appointed Public Administration Minister at 2 p.m. on Monday. But mere minutes before being sworn in, an announcement from the Office of the Prime Minister that Dr. Keith Rowley will now take over the portfolio instead. The statement said new information had come to light about Simonet, though no specifics were given. Simonet, an attorney at law, was chosen to replace corruption-accused Marley McDonald, who now faces money laundering and fraud charges. But was a driving under the influence charge 5 years ago in Florida the determining factor for renouncing his appointment? And if so, did the government drop the ball in exercising due diligence when screening him as a prospective minister? These were among the questions we were hoping to pose to Prime Minister Dr. Keith Rowley. However, all calls and messages via WhatsApp were unsuccessful. According to information from the Brevard County Sheriff's Office, Simonet was charged in 2014 for a DUI and appeared in court 1 month later. An image of what appears to be a mugshot accompanies the details of Simonet's booking. In September 2018, he was appointed a temporary government senator. Did Simonet disclose his run-in with the law, and did those charged with the responsibility of conducting background checks unearth the information? CNC3 News understands there is no policy in place to conduct background checks. However, the Prime Minister can request due diligence be done on potential ministers. We understand that while the police service has the capability to do thorough checks, no request from OPM was made for help.
Meantime, former Public Administration Minister Marlene McDonnell has been granted bail in the sum of $2 million. The charges against her were read in absentia yesterday afternoon after she was admitted to the St. Clair Medical Hospital being treated for an undisclosed ailment.
The Port of Spain South MP's case was conducted in absentia at the Port of Spain Magistrates Court on Monday. She was granted bail in the sum of $2 million. She, along with her husband, Michael Carew, and three others were charged with several offences, including conspiracy to defraud the government. Mr. Carew was also granted bail in the sum of $500,000, as eight charges were laid against him. Three contractors were also granted bail in the sum of $1.5 million. They are Edgar Zephyrin, who is facing 28 charges and was slapped with $1 million bail, while Victor McEachran is facing five charges and was granted $400,000 bail. Wayne Anthony has one charge. He was granted $100,000 bail. They will all reappear in court on September 9th.